So overall, my dissertation zooms in on fundamental strategic dilemmas that diplomats deal with through their communication. On the one hand, they need to communicate clearly and recognizable and credible identities of the international actors they represent. At the same time, they need to engage communicative ambiguity to remain flexible towards changes in their political surroundings. To study how diplomats handle such dilemmas in their work, I develop a theoretical conceptualization of how we can study diplomatic strategic communication, what I call diplomatic stratcom, as the way diplomats deal with fundamentally different and often conflicting aims in their work. So, when diplomats engage clarity in their communication, this can help them to support the constitution of actors and help them secure favorable positions in the international arena. So we see good examples of this in the public diplomacy literature, for example. And when diplomats engage communicative ambiguity, it helps them to keep room to maneuver, remain flexible to pursue context-specific foreign policy interests, and keep conflicting parts around a table. So a good example of this is the literature on constructive ambiguity in diplomacy. In strategic corporate communications literature, this puzzling coexistence of communicative clarity and ambiguity in strategic communication has been highlighted. However, in international relations literature, these communicative dynamics have been treated separately and mostly indirectly, but not studied together as a fundamental communicative dynamic that Stratcom needs to balance. Furthermore, mainstream perspectives on strategic communication often defines it as the purposeful use of communication by an organization to fulfill its mission or aim. My dissertation enhances the knowledge about how Stratcom works when it needs to balance multiple coexistent and even contradictory aims at the same time. I argue that this is vital to understand Stratcom in diplomatic work, since diplomacy is about balancing contradicting political interests that coexist internally and externally in states and international organizations. So while studying the EU's Russia policy, both in the literature and through interviews with EU and member state diplomats, I identify two conflicting aims that these diplomats simultaneously need to support through their stratcom. So first is the wish to consolidate the EU as a unitary security actor standing firm against a hostile and challenging Russia. Another aim is the desire to remain able to cooperate with Russia in spite of current diplomatic crisis with sanctions and counter-sanctions. So in the literature, the aim too about diplomatic flexibility is described through how the EU has through history continuously balanced between simultaneously dealing with Russia as a partner, but also a threat, and also the fact that EU member states have fundamentally different relations with Russia. Internally, the need for flexibility is also supported by the EU's need to balance its supranational and intergovernmental levels of its foreign policy, and also the ambition of both advancing itself as a normative power while, for example, when dealing with Russia, also needing to be very pragmatic at times. So in one of actor constitution is oppositely supported by the internal processes of strengthening the EU as a security actor. And this wish is, for example, clearly narrated through the EU global strategy of 2016, where also Russian threats are clearly narrated. So in order to study how diplomats pursue such conflicting aims and how they balance between communicative clarity and ambiguity through strategic communication, I formulated this research question. What is diplomatic stratcom, and how is it possible for diplomats to perform stratcom in a way that enables them to successfully manage the often contradictory requirements of diplomatic flexibility and actor constitution? And here the first ambition is to conceptualize the fundamentals of diplomatic stratcom as something core to internal strategic processes in diplomatic organizations. And the second part is related to my case study, where I aim to scrutinize the strategic tensions between different fundamental aims in the EU's Russia policy. First, to obtain an overview over existing definitions of strategic communications in international relations, I read a lot of different literature. For example, on strategic communication as part of public diplomacy and nation branding, military stratcom and psyops, hybrid threats and disinformation. Since I didn't come across literature in international relations looking at stratcom as something supporting more fundamental internal strategic processes in international organizations, I have been working interdisciplinarily, and I studied a broad array of literature from organization management and communication studies as well. For example, a communicative constitution of organization perspectives, narrative perspectives, those of collective action. For example, strategy as practice, branding literature, and traditional strategic communication and strategy literature that focuses on aims, objectives, and tactics, and so on. So in relation to strategic communication in diplomacy studies, I ended up identifying a gap when it came to the focus on the internal workings of communication. Often diplomatic communication and stratcom in international relations also focus a lot on external audiences, so either publics or among negotiation partners. And hereby, they lack attention to, for example, the constitutive effects of communication internally in organizations. So to close this gap, I engage literature on narratives, taking my point of departure in Niskanen and company's strategic narrative framework and their useful distinction between constitutive and behavioral communication power, since this reflected the differences between the two strategic aims I had identified in my case. However, quite late in my research process, after having started analyzing my interview data, I realized that to understand more nuances on how diplomats actually do things with narratives as part of communicating strategically, I needed to engage a practice perspective. So a narrative or pure communication focus is often weak on the role of organizational practitioners as narrators, such as diplomats. Especially strategic narrative literature pays much attention to the narratives of collective actors, and too little on how practitioners deal with the many coexisting narratives in their internal strategizing. So I identified diplomatic stratcom as narrative practices based on my empirical observations of how diplomats did things with narratives in my interviews. So my basic definitions of diplomatic stratcom is that it is a practice related to the fulfillment of multiple strategic aims and that it comprises of narrative practices that diplomats perform. And here diplomats' narrative practices can either be that of creating coherent narratives by stringing events together, creating a sense of time, creating certain actor roles and plots calling for certain actions. And it can also be juggling coexisting narratives. So I found that the EU's Russia policy was a really good case for studying stratcom because Russia is a challenging partner and the EU member states have diverging policies. In this way, I found that the EU's Russia policy was kind of a least likely to be successful case of stratcom. So a case that would reveal some of the tensions of doing stratcom. So empirically, I read EU policy documents related to foreign policy on Russia, a few internal working documents, EU public communication, but my main sources comprised 47 interviews, both with EU and member state diplomats, including 14 different nationalities across four different locations. So I made this broad selection to avoid too much national bias and strengthen the generalizability of my findings. So my primary focus was on the diplomatic community in Moscow, where I interviewed diplomats at the delegation, the EU delegation, especially heads of different sections there, and diplomats at national member state embassies. I tried to include, to create like geographical variation. So I have both interviewed member states from Northern European member states, Central European member states, and Southern European member states. Here I made a deliberate choice not to interview diplomats who work as public diplomacy or communications officers, since I experienced that they often had this focus on the external communication. So instead, by interviewing diplomats working at the political sections, I was better able to scrutinize the internal workings. So I interviewed, for example, deputy heads of missions or heads of political sections and first secretaries and the like. And then in Brussels, I interviewed some diplomats from the External Action Service working at the Russia desk, the Ukraine desk, or the East Stratcom team, and a few member state diplomats working on member states' EU representations as well. And in Moldova and Ukraine, I also interviewed some diplomats from the EU delegations and member states to understand the role of Russia seen from the Eastern Partnership. And I anonymized all my interviews, which is, of course, dissatisfying if you're interested in learning about the specific positions of member states. But then, the point of my my analysis was to observe narrative practices that can be deemed competent across the EU diplomatic community. So I don't feel that this anonymization affected my findings. So through ongoing dialogue with the literature and my interviews, I developed a conceptualization for studying diplomatic stratcom. The first premise was that diplomats support different aims. So I conceptualized the aim of keeping diplomatic flexibility to cooperate with Russia as a generic behavioral aim, and the aim of consolidating the EU as a unified actor vis-a-vis Russia as a generic constitutive aim. So following, I conceptualized two different kinds of stratcom that respectively support each of these aims. So behavioral stratcom supports diplomats' ability to perform agency in relation to a specific situation or context. For example, when they mobilize certain narrative resources to advance certain foreign policy interests. Behavioral stratcom can also be when diplomats structure their narrative environment in a way that equips them with narrative positions that expand their room to maneuver at a later stage. And constitutive stratcom supports the long-term strategic processes of creating international actors who are perceived as legitimate actors with the ability to act and to claim certain identity traits, values, and characteristics. It is thus being concerned with talking collective actors into being, for example, by promoting communicative alignment, strategic coherence, and by making different identity claims on behalf of a collective actor. I also argue that behavioral stratcom is widely built upon the logic of communicative ambiguity, while constitutive stratcom favors the logic of communicative clarity. While these stratcom tracks are strategic within their own logic, they nevertheless contain the inherent risk of creating a strategic gap between them. And in order for diplomats to close this gap, they engage a third form of stratcom, which I call bridging stratcom. This concept is inspired by branding literature, in which communication plays a central role in creating communicative fit and close gaps between different communication tracks. Here, bridging stratcom is primarily internal in the sense that the purpose is to diminish incongruences between other stratcom tracks and to enforce narrative synergies internally. So while analyzing these different stratcom processes in my interviews with diplomats, I look for two forms of diplomats' narrative practices that support different strategic aims. So I look for how diplomats craft coherent narratives by engaging a structural narrative analysis and thematic narrative analysis. And then I look for how they invoke narrative meaning. And by invoking narratives, they narrated smaller parts of a narrative or simply used specific words which would lead the attention to a specific narrative. For example, diplomats never told me the full story of the Ukraine crisis, or rarely did. Instead, they engaged the narrative through specific words, what I call narrative markers, that direct attention to the narrative. For example, simply the words Ukraine, Donbas, Crimea. Okay, so in my first analysis, I analyze constitutive stratcom by answering the working question, how do diplomats support the internal constitution of the EU as a unitary actor vis-a-vis Russia? So I identify different narrative practices that build on a logic of communicative clarity. And you can see the list here on the slide, just to provide a few examples. A central narrative practice was that of the construction of different crisis narrative. So as a fundamental component in diplomats' constitutive stratcom, they constructed the Ukraine crisis narrative. So this is represented by the yellow arrow on the slide. And this narrative put the Russian annexation of Crimea in 2014 as a first scene in a story arguing that Russia fundamentally broke the rules of the international system and how this was a point of no return in EU-Russia relations. So here the main function was to mobilize member states that are not traditionally concerned with Russian threats, to unite them around the fundamental values of sovereignty and self-determination. And into this narrative, diplomats also built a conditionality principle, implying that member states can only break EU sanctions unity when Russia has fulfilled its obligations under the Minsk agreements. So, since it soon became clear that Russia was not willing to comply with this conditionality principle, diplomats used narrative practices to keep the impetus of unity and basically to keep member states committed to sanctions. They did so by linking different other instances of Russian hostile actions into an overall narrative about Russian threats. And through this linkage, they changed the underlying aim of the sanctions unity from that of solving the Ukraine crisis to that of keeping EU unity against Russian threat as a main aim in itself. And by embedding these two other narratives into an even broader narrative of the EU being under threat generally on a global level, the diplomats raised the stakes of breaking EU unity even further and created a stronger sense of urgency for EU unity. These were some examples of how diplomats' creation and linkage of clear crisis and threat narratives supported the EU's constitutive aim of keeping unity to support the ongoing processes of EU active constitution. And here, some of the main functions of constitutive stratcom that I found was the ability to mobilize for unity, maintain the impetus of collective action, and to blur internal discrepancies. So in my second analysis, I focus on how communicative ambiguity is embedded into narrative practices of the diplomats. So I answer the question, how do diplomats maintain diplomatic flexibility in a time dominated by crisis narratives and external clashes of narratives? So the internal disagreements of the EU's Russia policy constitute the main need for communicative ambiguity. And for example, this is why the EU has not a real Russia strategy at the moment, since strategy is built on communicative clarity. In one of my interviews, a diplomat explained that the EU does not have a Russia strategy because it is a high conflict policy area. So the diplomat provided some examples for comparison. And this diplomat said, within some of the areas where there is a strategy, the gap, the potential political dispute is smaller. Why don't we have a USA-Trump strategy? Striking. Why can we have a strategy for the Arctic? Why can we have an Eastern Partnership strategy? Because these are low-tension areas. So instead of making an actual Russia strategy, the EU member states agreed on the EU's five guiding principles for EU-Russia relations in 2016. And these principles are a good example of behavioral stratcom. They work as a dual track policy framework and balance between relations of condemnation and cooperation. So the first three examples on the slide regarding Minsk agreements and sanctions, the EU's insistence on the Eastern Partnership cooperation, and the EU's wish to strengthen resilience against Russian hybrid threats, they represent a policy line of condemning Russia's actions. The two last principles, arguing for the need of having selective engagement with Russia and expanding people-to-people contacts, they reflect a policy line of cooperation. So to balance this dual-track approach, this is an example of how constructive ambiguity inbuilt in the framework minimizes the risks of internal narrative clashes by both enabling member state hardliners and member states who are more Russia-friendly to contribute to the EU framework. And this ambiguity also disables critics to fixate the EU either in a pure, the EU is against Russia, or the EU is too soft on Russia box. So by analyzing my interviews, I also identified how behavioral stratcom worked through the coexistence of different backstories that diplomats engaged in different contexts to legitimize respectively a more cooperative or conflictual approach to Russia. So in the model on the picture, backstory one to the right attributes Russia the role of an unavoidable partner. Oppositely, backstory two attributes Russia the role as inherently threatening and challenging. In backstory three, Russia's challenging behavior is explained as defensive acts, for example, against the EU and NATO enlargement. And backstory four narrated Russia as an actor who is isolating itself on the international arena and retracting. So by shifting between these different backstories, diplomats obtained flexibility to read more or less conflict into the current diplomatic crisis, or to stress the need for cooperation in spite of, for example, sanctions. Communicative clarity is useful for galvanizing support for example, sanctions policy, and communicative ambiguity helps diplomats to stay operational and able to pursue different strategic interests, both in the EU's and member states' Russia policies. And here, the main functions of behavioral stratcom that I identified was to prevent exposing internal conflicts, to create political room for maneuver, and to enable contradicting actor roles to coexist. So in my third analysis, I show how these coexisting tracks of constitutive and behavioral stratcom create some underlying strategic challenges in my case of the EU's Russia policy. So I answer the question, how do diplomats' attempts to simultaneously support actor consolidation and diplomatic flexibility impact their ability to perform a consistent Russia policy? And here I have some illustrative examples of these clashes. The two first examples shows how clarity and the aim of actor constitution challenges the aim of flexibility. So the first example is how crisis narratives enhance the risk of narrative clashes between the EU and Russia, and that these clashes challenges diplomatic dialogue. So for example, even if diplomatic cooperation is going on in Russia, several diplomats describe that the clash of narratives often lead to a kind of mandatory blame game when they meet with Russian counterparts. And this was seen as a challenge or at least a disturbing factor for traditional diplomatic dialogue or more cooperative dialogue. And this points to the inherent dilemma. Should diplomats aim to create clear crisis narrative with the ability to strengthen internal unity, or should they seek to downplay these clashes of narratives in order to work for collective EU interests with the Russians? Another strategic class was to be found between the clearly articulated sanctions conditionality, which challenges diplomats' flexibility to cooperate with Russia. And here Russia's unwillingness to comply with the EU sanctions conditionality locks some of the EU diplomats' room to maneuver to the implementation of Minsk agreements on an indefinite timeframe. So the last three examples are examples of how communicative ambiguity and the aim of flexibility challenges EU Act Constitution. So for example, the first one of how ambiguity, the ambiguity related to the principle of selective engagement in the five guiding principles. This selective engagement principle enables member states to widely pursue positive relations with Russia in spite of the current sanctions. So this meant that many member states took up high-level dialogues with Russia during, for example, 2015. And when the High Representative Mogherini came to Moscow in 2016, it gave the impression of an EU being in the backseat. And this was something that weakened the collective EU position vis-a-vis Russia. In the same way, the practice of minimum narration supports flexibility, but at the same time, it weakens a sense of a clear and unified strategic direction in the EU-Russia policy. Also, the EU's pragmatism on human rights enables some member states to free ride to a certain extent and to pursue bilateral interests, but it also weakens the EU's overall ability to construct itself as a normative power in the EU-Russia policy. So in my fourth analysis, I answered the question, how do diplomats deal with strategic challenges that emerge between their simultaneous attempts to support actor consolidation and diplomatic flexibility? And here my point is that since strategic communication are narrative practices that are part of diplomatic work, they cannot easily be changed. So here breeding Stratcom is an internal and more reactive way of trying to mend gaps. So for example, I identified how many diplomats indirectly narrated the EU slogan United in Diversity as an underlying meta-narrative that, for example, could be used to explain critics why Hungary and Poland are not sanctioned when they challenge the EU's value foundation. So here, meta-narrative is not understood as a grand societal story, but closer to a concept of meta conversation in strategy of practice literature. So it is an underlying narrative structure that enable and interlink some disconnected internal narrative domains to create a sense of connectedness in spite of internal contradictions. I also observed how diplomats integrated the logic of the concept for EU integration, so-called multi-speed Europe concept, into the area of the Russia policy. So hereby they turned internal polyphony of member states' Russia policies into an active element of the EU's Russia relations. However, in my case, I show that bridging Stratcom is not strong enough to bridge the gap between constitutive and behavioral Stratcom. So this shows us that the EU and member state diplomats dealing with Russia, they face an ongoing dilemma that if they engage in narrative processes of consolidating the EU acts vis-a-vis Russia, they may damage the EU's ability to develop a partnership with Russia. Conversely, cooperating with Russia risks watering down some of the constitutive processes of making an EU security actor that stands firm against Russia. So put very roughly, the dilemma is should the EU diplomats strengthen the EU's position and as an international actor vis-a-vis Russia, or should they mend the relations with Russia? So I name this dilemma the actor flexibility gap in the EU's Russia policy that diplomats have yet not been able to bridge sufficiently. Of course, I'm aware that a broader study of their ability to actually manage the actual flexibility gap also needs to include other central internal and external narrative dynamics as well. An additional observation that I did while interviewing diplomats was that they often narrate their work with EU-Russia diplomacy on three different narrative levels. So at the bottom of the table, I identified a narrative macro level, and this is where the diplomats construct the identities of the international macro actors like Russia and the EU. On the narrative meso level, they construct the professional identities of themselves and their own logics and raison d'etre for conducting proper diplomacy. And then on the macro level, this was where they narrated their context-specific experiences from being posted, for example, in Moscow. And I think this last observation could be a useful contribution to the strategic narrative literature in international relations, because I see that they often have a tendency to focus on macro narratives when analyzing international conflicts. And here my aim is to point to the narrative formation on the lower levels, so ultimately being able to understand also the narratives of the practitioners interacting and dealing with these conflicts. So others have studied this, but I think that my stratification of the narrative levels poses a promising way to study the interlinkage of narratives and practices that could nuance, for example, the studies of narrative struggles between EU-Russia and the actual impact of these narrative struggles on the diplomatic relations. So my contribution to international relations in general, here I think that my the framework I developed for studying diplomatic stratcom as narrative practices that support or bridge conflicting strategic aims internally in international relations, and my focus on the interplay between communicative clarity and ambiguity, is a focus to strengthen studies of on the intra-organizational strategic narrative dynamics. And then for the EU literature on diplomatic practices, here I think that my study strengthens a focus on communicative practices. So what do diplomats actually do when they do things with narratives? For example, Adler Nissen in 2009 wrote about diplomats' practices in EU diplomacy that in late sovereign order, states are trying to speak with one voice and may even attempt to suppress their own voice. So basically my study answers, how do diplomats speak with one voice, or how do they avoid to do so? That is also a contribution. Then to EU-Russia studies, empirical insights on narratives in EU diplomacy vis-a-vis Russia, and then also my conceptualization of the actor flexibility gap. And then I think I also have a contribution to practitioners who work with strategic communication in international affairs. I think my framework can propose a way to analyze and understand some of the internal strategic cross pressures that they experience in their work. At least I think my model has a practical touch in the sense that I could see myself doing communication in a complex setting using the logics of behavioral and constitutive aims and also the logic of bridging stratcom to solve some of the problems that emerge along the way. This was it. I want to thank you all for your time.